Several years ago, browser was the hottest platform in gaming. Then Facebook became clearly the hottest platform. Now we have mobile as the hottest platform. And while there are always some differences between the platforms, there are a lot of patterns that repeat themselves over and over again. And I'm going to speak about these patterns that I observed to give you a better understanding of what will go on in the future and how you can profit from the observations that probably you made as well on previous games platforms. First, a few words about me. I'm a serial entrepreneur. I co-founded several companies. And the third company I co-founded was SponsorPay, a company probably most of you know. And currently, I co-founded Hitfox. And we started Hitfox with one company in game distribution and now expanded it to a whole group of companies within game distribution. And two of our companies are in mobile game distribution, that's Applift and GameFinder. And one is in online game distribution, that's Etugames, a company we bought from GameForge about 9 months ago. First, let me give you the reasons why platform patterns exist. Basically, platforms are a bit like countries or like societies. Both have rules and regulation on the platform. So they both have somehow a platform owner, which can be either democratical or dictatorial or somehow in between, if you see some similarities between Apple and Google here. And then platforms also live in cycles. That means they have cycles of growth and of decline. And on these platforms, there is competition. And the platforms itself are in competition with each other. And then probably most importantly, and everybody who is developing on a platform, on a not open platform like the web, everybody who is developing on Facebook or on Apple knows they have a pretty high VAT tax. And this is a lot of similarities you have between platforms and countries. Basically, we could say countries and societies are platforms without the effects of an underlying technology. And as history repeated itself over and over through, through the history of mankind, also platform history repeats itself. And I'm going to talk about the patterns that made the biggest impact there, probably that you've all observed within browser gaming, and that will now also have an effect on how mobile gaming is developing. And yeah, with the right conclusions drawn from that, hopefully you can take something out to make your companies more successful. So basically, whenever a new platform emerges, that platform, could it be Facebook, could it be the open web, or could it be mobile, it comes with new technology standards. And so basically, you need new coding skills to be successful on the platform. It all works a bit different than on the previous platform. So it's specificity. You must really focus on this technology in the beginning to be able to program good games on that platform. Then each platform comes also with platform policies and rules again, which are different from the rules and behavior another platform owner might expect. And then the audiences are different, like the audience on Facebook when it emerged was very different to the audience of core games, which had some implications on the gameplay which was needed. And basically, whenever that leads to whenever all these changes happening, there are organizations needed that focus only on the specific knowledge of the new platform. That means if mobile is coming up and you want to be successful on mobile, you need a part of your team or better, a separate division to be focused only on mobile, mobile, mobile to get what's happening there, how tracking works, how all the different viral and distribution mechanisms work. So when a platform emerges, that leads to the emergence of new organizations, probably startups, and in the end, they form a totally new ecosystem which is in relation to the ecosystem of other platforms before, because in the end they are all connected, but it's important to know there is a new ecosystem. And a good proof for that, or some observation, is whenever there are new conferences focused on one platform, like the Browser Games Conference emerged in probably 2005, I think, very long ago. That means a new ecosystem was forming itself. And then today you see some mobile platforms emerging. And in the US, you saw a lot of social games conferences emerging. And this is always an indicator a new ecosystem is in the making. So what are the most important platform patterns I observed? So basically, there are definitely much more out, and probably you know some and are also happy to share them. But what I saw, and which is sometimes, rather obvious. So the first and one of the most important is the platform hype cycle. So basically, when a new platform emerged, like browser gaming, probably in Germany 2004, around that time, in the beginning there is nothing, and the companies who found the market, the gap, become very, very successful within a short time. It's a highly attractive market. Everybody is earning very well on very high margins. The competition is low. So it's just so attractive to go into this market. And once it's observed, then a lot of new competitors move in and it's still attractive. And then once you are at the point when there's too much competition and the growth you have seen before is slowing down, but the participants from the outside see it with a lag. So new participants move in and the economic conditions within this platform or within this market get worse. And what's then happening as you come to a changing point, to a climax, and then everybody feels like, so much competition here, it's not really attractive to be here. And then all the expectations go down, investors see it's not attractive at all, and then that's a decline of the platform. And this is also, both directions go into an exaggeration. It's like with stock markets or other hype cycles you can observe. Basically, it's important to know there is a growth period which will exaggerate, there's a decline, and later it's all going back to normal. And we are now in a decline of browser gaming. It's still a bit earlier for mobile, but I will talk a bit later on one of the other slides about where do we probably stand in mobile gaming and how long will the growth period last, if it lasts. So important to take away is the platform hype cycle exists, and you must anticipate it for thinking about investments, getting investments, but also for thinking about investing in users and investing in your CLV. How much are you prepared to spend for a user if you know probably in 1 year there are thousands of games competing, and the amount of CLV per user is going down. And yeah, just be aware of that. Then another very important shift I see, for example, and this is not only true for B2C, but also for B2B markets, is the shift you need to do from marketing to product. So basically, whenever there's a new market or a new product, there are uninformed customers. They don't know the product, they don't know a comparison, there is no good media to report about that and have a filtering function. So they're just uninformed and probably take what they see first or take what they see most often presented or most convincingly presented. That leads to a situation where on a new market, like browser gaming was in 2004, 2005, 2006, you just need to present them banners, they will click, they will play your game, and since they have no comparison possibilities, they will probably like it because they are uninformed. Then once the platform or the market or the games mature, the users become educated. And while in the beginning, focus on marketing was the most successful tactic, later on, you have to be aware users can see through your marketing, they're educated, there's media, separating the goods from the bads, and basically on mature platforms or market, marketing is not as important anymore. It's about the real product behind, which means with a maturing platform, games become and must become much better. And in the end, games, even without any or only small marketing, but just based on the power of how good they are, can make it, while other games with big marketing budgets that don't have good products will fail. So you should use this knowledge to focus on marketing first whenever there's a new platform. And this is now Heiko is smiling, not sure whether he agrees, but from a business perspective, it's the right move. And focus on marketing first, but then make sure once the users get informed and once everybody is informed, then it's the product that matters in the end. So use the traction you get from the marketing and then build the best product. In the end, if you can build the best product already in the beginning, that's even better. But be aware that marketing wins on new platforms. And a bit combined with that is the wild, wild west that happens on new platforms. If you look at Facebook, when they just opened up their API, the companies that were successful were really marketing-driven companies like Zynga, and they were happy to move west to the wild, wild west, where there was not a big regulation. You could do horrible, viral things to get new users, and in the end, didn't really get punished for that in the early times. So based on their wild, wild west tactics, both in distribution, but also in monetization, they could really build a huge user base. And later, then Facebook started to regulate that, and same happens on the Apple platform. Right now, it becomes much more complicated to do that, and in the end, it's not a worthwhile strategy anymore. But based on the aggressive marketing you did in the beginning, you own the users and the chances. There was no major company banned for that on Facebook. Some smaller ones got banned, but in the end, the big ones all profited from the aggressive early marketing strategies. So in the early times of a platform, it can be highly successful to be aggressive in marketing. Later, be aware the platform owner will cut that down, and in the end, everybody must behave to his rules. And some get punished, but most and thousands got away without any punishment. Then, combined with that increasing power of the platform owner, basically, when a platform is new and don't has a lot of users, the platform owner has low power and he's really running after you developers to get you on the platform to make his product attractive for the users. And so he has low power and is really doing you favors and is very supportive and answers your questions fast. Later, once the platform is mature, has a billion users, is growing, super successful, and the value for you to be on the platform is super high and you are already there, then the power of the platform owner comes, which can lead to bad support behavior, some own tactics. He will probably, some platform owner, copy the best applications on the platforms. And so there are a lot of dangers. And also in the end, with the increasing power of the platform owner, eventually he might increase the VAT you are paying for doing business in his country. Then be aware that this pattern happens, and always try to be super early on new platforms when you think they have the potential. But be aware you're doing business in somebody else's house, and eventually he might change the rules with you being in a very poor position going against that. And so limit the investments you make based on the risks that are there underlying in being in somebody else's house. Related to this, one more thought. So how do you do that? How do you start when you're an established browser or other platform type company, how do you innovate to move to a new platform? So what most companies do is basically they start a separate department for doing that. But the problem is this department doesn't have enough legitimation for really for doing and this department doesn't have enough legitimation for really making fast moves. They always have to ask for permission. They don't have real ownership because they don't have any shares or strong incentives in what they're doing. So they will do the job of a department and they won't take full ownership. They won't be fully behind. And often it can be seen that on the very new platforms, only the very specific entities, like new companies or very separated entities of established companies, have been successful. So my suggestion, and this is what we did at Hitfox, we had the online games ad network. It would be most natural to start mobile games. Also from that, within that network, no, we started a separate company with separate management and incentives to be really focused on the new platform, and it's working pretty well that that way. The trend of acceleration is also pretty important in my eyes. So basically we had, we are coming from a world of boxed distribution, which had its own rules, its own ecosystem, and that worked for a long while. And then in 2004, 2005, at least in Germany, browser gaming came up, had totally different rules, how distribution worked, how production worked. In the end, created a new ecosystem that was very different from the previous ecosystem and from the rules, how it all worked out. And that was in 2005. Then we saw a trend of 4 to 5 years of strong growth before consolidation happened in the new ecosystem. That was in the end in 2009, 2010. And along a very long growth period where a lot of people made kind of a fortune, especially also in Germany. And then in 2008, we had a new ecosystem emerging. That was social, with most importantly Facebook. And while boxed game ecosystem was here, browser was here, the Facebook ecosystem was rather here. So a new ecosystem, but pretty close to the ecosystem of browser gaming, because it was also digital, you had customer lifetime values, it was about free to play. A lot of similarities between browser and Facebook, which in the end led to lower entrance barriers for publishers from browser to Facebook than it was before from the boxed game world to browser. And also the browser guys, as a boxed game guys, at least they had seen it happening on browser. So eventually EA moved in and some other companies also became successful on Facebook. So there was more competition based on nearby platforms. And so the growth trend on Facebook for gaming lasted about 2.5 years, something like that, much shorter than it was on browser. And now, most recently, we have the emergence of then mobile as a platform. And with the new mobile platform emergence, that's also again close to social and close to browser as an ecosystem. And so it's a third digital distribution platform. And basically, because there were two learning cycles for all the other guys in the gaming market, the entry barriers again became lower. And now there are mobile publishers that started as mobile publishers on mobile. Then there are the social guys moving in fast, the browser guys move in, and the boxed game guys of the old world are also moving in. So in effect, that will lead to a situation where the growth cycle from platform emerges to consolidation is much shorter. And this is what can already be seen, which expresses itself in the high customer acquisition costs you pay on mobile. So basically, be prepared. Competition on mobile gaming will heat up faster than on any other platform before. And everybody who is on mobile knows it. It's already there. It's not that paradise times of browser gaming how it was in 2006, 2007. So you really have to be competitive to be successful on mobile. Coming from a situation where we now have four, or when I count iOS and Android as two different platforms, we have now four different ecosystems in digital gaming. And they all become more and more mature. And whenever a platform is new, like mobile, like Facebook, like browser, it's super important to be very focused only on the platform, because there's a high specificity in how are you doing the code, how is virality working, how is distribution in general working, and how is monetization working, how does the platform owner behave. So on new platforms, you must be focused very much on the platform, because that's the single most important factor who can secure or not secure your dominance, your success on the platform. Once a platform becomes older, is probably 3-4 years old, then this platform specificity knowledge becomes a commodity. So a lot of people can build games and distribute games on Facebook now. And in the end, that means it's not so much about knowing how you buy Facebook ads professional. It's then more about how to build the best games and how to know your audience, which in the end is more of a general gaming core competence. That means classic game companies have their chance based on the IP they have, based on the general gaming DNA their company hopefully have, to build the best games and be able to do all the things they need to do on a platform. So that leads to a situation when platforms mature, also all the classic companies have chances, and it's more about doing the best product on the platform and not about managing the platform and putting some product on it, which in the end will be successful if you only understand the platform mechanics. So with the maturing four platforms, gaming companies must shift from being focused on a platform to being focused on one audience or one genre of games. So we are now still talking about a company to be a browser games company, a mobile games company, a social games company. In 3 years, there will probably not be a single mobile games company. There will be games companies that are focused on one specific genre. Like a wargaming company is very successfully focusing only on doing 3D heavy graphic games for males in the war genre. And basically, they will be able to distribute their games on any platforms and build the best games in that genre. So your competitive advantage must come from being strong in one audience or one genre of games, which also leads to potential cross promotion you have. And it's then not so much more about being focused on one platform. So if you have one strong IP, like Rovio has with Angry Birds, the incentive is so big to distribute it on all platforms. And this will happen in the future. So companies, gaming companies, will not be so much mobile gaming companies. They will be companies that work for a specific audience or a specific genre and must find their competitive advantage in doing that. And there might be still a very few players who can be successful in all genres and all platforms, but I think this will be rather the case of only 1, 2, 3 big companies. Then, what do I think is going to happen? That's what I talked before about. So the key to success, how gaming will develop, is focus on one specific audience and genre. Do that right. Know your gamers. Know the media important for those gamers, and then make sure you do cross promotion right and you are credible within your audience group. You've built a brand for building children games, for building 3D heavy shooter games or for casual games, and then stick to your audience and target group and build a competitive advantage there. And whenever a new platform emerges, then it's your chance to grab the lands there with a new separate entity that you spin off, which has an independent management, which is focused and has the incentives to really only think about this platform. Could it be maybe TV the next? And then only thinks TV, TV, TV. How does the distribution work? Who are the media partners to talk with for that? And in the end, this will be the strategy successful then for the next 2 years or 1 year on this platform, and then all the other companies will move in, and then it's again about that, which is probably the longest lasting and most important core competence still in the gaming industry. It's about, in the end, making great games, and I think that's something where I can't tell you anything about. That's what you know, and so I'm concluding with this and say thank you for your attention, Offenbach. Thanks.